Ladies and gentlemen, we're all here to get the tools that we need to spank the competition. Things are competitive out there. These are the best of times for some and the worst of time for others. And let me tell you, those of us who are in the business of spank, and that is spanking the competition, are looking at these as the optimum time to go out there in the world and do the spank. Now, we have to ask ourselves this question. What is the purpose of club? That's the very first thing we're talking about. And the first thing we're talking about is to fill the big empty. Ladies and gentlemen, what we're talking about is feeding the big hunger. We are on a mission from God, ladies and gentlemen, and that is our goal. Feeding the big hunger is what we're talking about right now. And believe me, at the Beach Club, we do that. Now, let me tell you, we were talking before about mission statements. Norm did a spectacular job, hundreds of them up there. Let me give you our mission statement, and every single one of my employees know this. We have a monthly all-staff meeting. They can make all sorts of bucks if they know this. And if they can explain this mission in terms of their department and in terms of the club, one, we are in the happiness business. How's that? That's complicated, right? Secondly, we are a home at the beach. And the third is, we are the new neighborhood. Now, why do we have that as our mission? Because we're filling the big empty. We are feeding the hunger, ladies and gentlemen. That's what we're talking about. So we're on a mission from God. As a matter of fact, I was doing some research last night, as each of you must be doing, right? I was watching The Blues Brothers. Has anybody seen that movie before? Fabulous movie, because they're on a mission from God, and that's what we're doing. And what is that mission, ladies and gentlemen? We're here to feed the big hunger. Now, what is the big hunger? Every time somebody considers going to your club, what they're asking themselves, can they fill my big hunger? Can they feed me what I need? Because I'm going to walk into that door and I'm lonely. I'm scared. I want dignity. I want status. And I want the buzz. So ask ourselves, how do we do that? How do we feed that? We feed it with three things, boys and girls. Relationships, community, and stuff. And it's so easy. People talk about stuff all the time, and it really depresses me. You know why? Because the Beach Club, we ain't got much stuff. Ha, ha, ha. We're not something special. I can't tell you on a $60 million budget, but I tell you what we do is we got the love. We got two things, I call it, ladies and gentlemen. When you're out there in the world, you're looking for one big happy. When you walk in that door, do you feel the buzz? Do you feel the love? Do you feel the glow? And I can guarantee you, a lot of the photographs I've seen this morning of the great clubs around the world don't show me none of that. And we spank the competition. As I like to say, in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. You don't, I do. We print money. You don't, I'm happy. And I like to tell people, you don't have to do anything I'm talking about. You can reject the whole thing, because I don't care, because we've been printing money lately. We print so much money. I mean, it's scary. Every year, this year, give you an example. We take 10% of the profits made above budget and just walk around and give it back to the staff. So this year we made, I think it was $357,000 more than we budgeted to make. And for a small funky club like ours, that's a lot of money. And to walk around and give that to the staff lets them know that we believe in their role in our success as a club. So we're here to give you relationships. Now let's go back again to my mission statement. What did I talk about? We're in the happiness business. Is that about the buzz, ladies and gentlemen? You know what's interesting? I watch people come in off the golf courses all around the world. You know what happens? They come in and they bitch and moan. Huh? They don't say, oh, I had a great round of golf. What a joy it was to shoot 175. I don't see that. They're not playing golf for the golf. You understand that, ladies and gentlemen? They're playing golf for other reasons. We have to understand what that is. You know, a person may join your club because they know every Saturday morning they can get three people they really like to play golf with them that day. Huh? That may be more important than who built your golf course, how many dollars that you're making, whatever it might be. These are huge things to keep in mind. And it's not about money. Throwing money at the problems will not solve those problems for you. Understand what we're trying to fill is the big empty, to feed the big hunger. People want relationships, they want community, and they want some stuff that's good services and program that give them the buzz. So come once again back to our mission statement. We're in the happiness business. I haven't heard any mission statement. Sorry, Norm, I love that stuff. Ain't none of them say we're in the happiness business. And that's what it is. You want to know why people don't leave my club? You know what the average age at the Beach Club is 63 years old. We have a woman, Liz Size, 95 years old, comes in a wheelchair every day into the club. She hasn't been on the beach in 50 years. What is she paying $450 a month to walk in that door for? For the love. She's looking for three things: the buzz, the love, and the glow. You know what the glow is? Humor. We talk about big happy. I walk into so many clubs around the world, and they're just miserable. Everybody is like they haven't had a vegetable or fruit in months. They're constipated. You know what I'm talking about? Right? I don't hear the humor. You know one of the metrics I would like to use in coming into your club? How much laughter do I hear? When the manager walks through the club, I want to see how many people laugh when the manager starts talking to them, when they start talking to the staff or the members. There is an equation out there between the amount of laughter in your club and the amount of success you have. I call that the big happy, right? That's the glow. What about the love? Walk through the club with the manager. I love to do it. Do it with me sometime at the beach club. I love it. How many love hugs do the women give you? Huh? How many of them walk up to the manager, give him the hug? How many kids come up to that manager, give him the knuckles and high five and say, you're the man? Huh? How many of your clubs do that? They do it in my club. And in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. I don't really give a good goddamn if you do it. But I'm going to throw out some ideas to you that you can use to whip the competition, to spank the competition. Now, why are you here? What tools are you going to get out of here? A couple of things, boys and girls. One, you're going to get education. They love to talk about education, but I like what Bill said. Ideas with utility is what you're after. And let me tell you, I'm a trench digger. I've been at the same club for 32 years, right? And the only reason they've kept me and they say nice things about me is because I'm printing money for them, huh? Then you say, oh, Gregg's a wonderful guy, but he lost money last year. He's gone. That hasn't happened, right? So we have to ask ourselves, what is it that we're delivering that's special? You're looking at the next generation. You know what I'm saying? It's back to the future. The next generation wants the same thing as the last generation wanted. They want it delivered differently, boys and girls. That's a big thing. They want it delivered differently, but they've still got the same hunger that needs to be fed. We just deliver it in a different way. So we're going to feed it. The hunger is the same. How we deliver the food is different. Now, I've just done research. You want to know about the future? You don't have to read no books. I can go with Peter down there. You know, I look at Peter from Singapore. I say, Peter, let's go down to Starbucks and do some research into what the next generation wants. I'll tell you what it is. I was in Changi Airport before I climbed on, interesting, Tiger Air. Is the representative from Tiger Air here? It was a great flight. Anyway, whatever it was, take Tiger Air, I have to tell you. But anyway, I'm sitting there and having some Starbucks because I needed the buzz. It was early in the day. I'd only had 3 cups of in-room coffee, and it was worthless. So I stopped into the Starbucks, and I'm sitting there, and I'm saying, what can I learn about the next generation for when I see you? First of all, you know what I found out? We are dealing with an experience economy. Huh? And your clubs, half your clubs don't have it. And I tell you what Starbucks does is right. They take a coffee bean and end up selling for $5 Singapore. Huh? How do they do that? Because they've added an experience to that stupid coffee bean. It was simply a good. It was a coffee bean. 2 cents to get the coffee. Then what they do is they make it in, that was a commodity, then they make it into a good. They cook it. Then there's a service, right? What happens then is that they brew it and they have a cup of coffee. That's ground zero. I look at your clubs and I'm sitting there and I'm saying, you know, the same thing is true in clubs, right? They start with a golf, they start with ground, they make a golf course, then they have a pro. That's ground zero. You're not going to win nothing with that. Do you understand, boys and girls? This is an experience economy. So I said, what is Starbucks doing that I can learn from, right? First of all, they add an experience to it that's special. You know what that is? And you better keep this in mind. They personalized and customized the experience. By way of example, you know, Peter, I love it. He didn't give me the $5 to buy that stupid cup of coffee, but that was the best research I ever had. I buy the coffee, give me this. And the girl's there, and she's chirping. She's jumping up and down. How are you? What is your name? Anybody know what I'm talking about? They write your name on the thing. So you go back. I'm just a nobody. I'm in Singapore. I don't know any of these people. And all of a sudden, Gregg, geeky white guy from California, where are you? And all of a sudden, I stand up. That's what your people want, right? You want customers? You've got to customize and personalize the experience. That's why when I was listening to the trip, my mind's gone blank, the golf trips that were there, what they're talking about is using technology to customize the golf experience. That's modernity. They will add experience to that pile. So when I look at Starbucks, I learned a great deal in Starbucks. And I said, okay, what am I going to do? Then I go back to my room last night. I've been talking to Norm Spitzig over here. This Norm is a writer. If you haven't read the stuff he's written, you're dumb as a rock. You ought to write. So I go up on Amazon. So I said, oh, can I learn something about the club business from Amazon.com? So I'm buying one of his books. Now, this is interesting, right? The book says, aha, we know what you want before you know what you want. Because he also wrote the Tao of Norm, or Norm Tao. said, what the hell is this? What people want from you is to anticipate needs before they even know they need it, right? So all of a sudden, Amazon, boy, what an education I'm getting here. And I haven't paid nothing from it. All I've done is look at the experiences I'm selling right now. Amazon's done well. Starbucks has done well. Huh? What have we learned from this about modernity? You don't have to take a seminar in. You just have to open your eyes, right? And then I'm sitting down last night, and I said, oh, God, it's about 1 o'clock in the morning. Of course, I can't sleep. I said, you know, I think I should watch a movie. So I picked up the Blues Brothers, right? Now, what is that telling me about modernity? One, they're on a mission from God, which is what we're talking about. But more importantly than that, they did everything in that movie that people say you cannot do. Isn't that not true? They destroyed everything. They drove the car through the parking, through the stores. I loved it. Destroy. When Bill started his film up here, destroy, take the bulldozer through, knock the goddamn things down, right? That's what they did. And I said, you know, that's what young people want. You know what young people want? You want to attract them to your clubs? They want to break through the constraints of civilization, at least for a small while. They want to release the animal spirits. What are you doing at your place to do that? I, on Labor Day weekend, which is a holiday, we do a Mai Tai Tower. How many of you have done a Mai Tai Tower on the first hole at your club where they tee off? Huh? Put a 20-foot tower there. Put your manager in the top of the tower. Dress him something weird. As a matter of fact, I think Peter would work perfectly in my Mai Tai Tower. Stand up there, and before everybody goes out, say, fire in the hole, and pour Mai Tai down, and watch it go around the tube, and they catch it down at the bottom, and everybody laughs. That's the glow, boys and girls. It's not about the golf. It's about the glow. Where have you brought glow into your organizations? We're talking about ideas with utility. You wonder why I attract young people and keep old people? The old people can't participate, but they love to watch people who can. Young people, you want to get 23, 24-year-old, up-and-coming technology multimillionaires? You better give them a bigger experience than they can get someplace else, right? These are very big issues, and if you can't do it, you lose. You know, at the beach club, you know why we're having so much fun? We can do anything we want. Nobody cares. You know why? Because we don't have the shackles of tradition around us. So many times we're talking, Paul's out there. Where are you, Paul? You're from France. France, right there. Let me tell you, these guys in France, you ought to talk to these guys. They're breaking through the barriers of tradition. Boom! We're going to look at golf a little bit differently, boys and girls. We're going to grow this game in our own unique and special way. Boom! There's your bulldozer right up there. I think it was great what Bill did here. Who is your bulldozer? The other thing is, you want to run a club and run it well? That's why we have the CMAA Asia. Because we want to give you the tools, right, ladies and gentlemen? You need a magician, right? You need somebody who can translate opportunity into action. Take vision and translate it into reality. That's the big thing. So how do you distinguish your club in a day and age? How do young people make the decision to spend all the money to come to your club, not once, but multiple times throughout the year, and then with their family and everything else? So you've got to do your research. Don't go to clubs. I'm not in the golf business. I'm in the beach club business. I'm in the happiness business. And it's interesting. I have so many opportunities to talk to club managers in golf. You know why? Because they're constrained. They have fences around their thinking. Well, I love it, boys and girls, because we have no fences. Nobody knows nothing about beach clubs. And because of that, we can do anything. Matter of fact, I'm looking at Michael Lemhos right there, one of the finest clubs in the world, Congressional Country Club. So he says, he goes to his board, because one of the most important things, and I'll talk about it, I think, in 2 days from now, is the nudge. I am an activist club manager. My job is to see the future and to nudge people in the direction so they get there. So Michael says, we need to become more family friendly. Our research, and he did a fabulous research report on this. You can pull it down online. I'm sure they can find it. Fabulous. He said, we must become more family friendly if we're going to spank the competition. And you say, holy smokes, congressional doesn't need to spank the competition. They're the ones that everybody else is trying to spank. Well, no. He says, we are going to keep spanking them. We're going to smack them down. We're going to bruise and injure them. We, the most traditional of clubs, the most blue blood of organizations, are going to go family friendly. And you know where it started? It started at the top, boys and girls. It started with somebody like Michael who says, I am the leader. I am your magician. I'm going to take ideas and I'm going to translate them into reality. So he hires this girl, and everybody says, oh, you shouldn't hire this girl, and why did you do that? He might have one of those $100 million clubs, and they were giving him a hard time about hiring somebody to head up his youth program. Think of that. Wild. So he sends this gal out to the beach club, because we're all Looney Tunes, right? And we got no money. We don't have the sort of bucks that they got, but we've got the buzz, we've got the love, and we got the glow. So she comes out there and she was doing somersaults. This gal is on fire, I said. So she went back and she began to transform their whole youth environment. But that's how it happens. You want to attract young families? Who's your Pied Piper? Ask yourself that question, huh? Who are the kids going to run up to and embrace at your club? Right? How about the women? I love to walk through the club. I like to see how many women there are. 45% of our members are women on their own. Huh? Figure that one out. You want to attract them? You want to get the future? You better go after the women and the kids. And what you're talking about is strategic planning. Absolutely. Where is there? Right? I like to say, I call it my barbell theory of leadership. You know what leaders do? Easy. They audit here. Exactly what he was doing. Assessment. Job one. Right, Norm? Right? You assess where it is. Then you say, where is there? The beach club, we're a funky little beach club. We're limited by the amount of money we have, whatever it might be. There is not, oh, we're going to be the best of anything. Why not? Well, we're in the happiness business. Then who's going to be on the bus with you? We're going back to Jim Collins now, what you were talking about. Read that book. Jim Collins got some great stuff out there. And one of his concepts is, who's on your bus, right? Who's driving your bus? Who's on the bus? Who is your team? What are the criteria you use? I'll give you mine. Two things. First of all, big happy. How's that? I hire happy people. You know, they can be dumb as a rock because I can train them most anything. You hire big happy and you hire big love. Now, I've gone to so many clubs throughout Europe and everywhere. And I go to the manager and I like to say, do they have big love? Huh? You know what big love is? Do they love the hospitality business, which is about bringing happiness to the world? That's peace. Do they love the club business? They really dig ongoing relationships with people. Next, do they dig the type of club they're at? I'm at a family club. Most of you might not like a family club. I love it. I came from a men's golf club. Actually, it's a boys' club. Fabulous club, the Bel Air Country Club in Los Angeles. I loved it until I found out that I really love family clubs more. Huh? Do you love that type of club? Do you love the staff and do you love the members? My board, because I'm looking for my own transition right now. They say, Gregg, what is the most important thing we should be looking for in the next manager? I said, that's easy. Two things, big love and big happy. If you've got those, you've got a winning combination. And I don't hear that as a criteria for the most managers. Being a CEO, a COO, an MBA, whatever it is, they're a dime a dozen. Does everybody understand? They're a dime a dozen. I hate to tell you that. If you think just being a great businessman is going to win the job for you, to distinguish you in a field of competence, you're completely wrong, boys and girls. You've got to have something else that distinguishes you from the world, just as your club must have distinguishers. Bill and everybody have been talking about this. What are your distinguishers in your club? Ask yourself this. Fill in this sentence. You got a new man. I'm considering going to your club. So James is down there. I said, James. Right. Fill in the sentence for me because I'm considering 10 different clubs. You'll know you're at my club because, fill in the sentence. Huh? And then I'll say, I want to see the single photograph that you will show me as a prospective member that captures your club. Mine would be a bunch of kids in my office laughing at the world. Huh? What picture describes you? What picture describes your club? How would you fill in that sentence? If you can't, you're in trouble. That's what it comes down to. So we're looking at it. Everybody says, oh, the next generation is different. And my big question, are we? I don't think they are. I think the big hunger exists with everybody. We just are filling it in different ways. I think the thing is that's happening in this day and age, it comes down to the bottom, people are more connected than ever, and they're lonelier than they've ever been before. Alone together is what we call it. How many people know what I'm talking about? They love to say, oh, I got 500 friends on Facebook or whatever it might be. You know what that means? They got no friends. Why did they come to the beach club? Because they're trying to connect what I call the sharp ends of the spear. Ultimately, all that technology does is get two people together, right? And our job is to create a product that's worthy of the message. You know one of the problems that I run into? People talk all the time about technology. They talk all the time about Facebook and social media and all that stuff. And I always say, the first thing I say, do you have a product that is equal to the message? And a lot of times they don't. I said, you know, the classic thing that Bill and everybody else is talking, how do they describe your club? What is that? So let's just go through the quick things right now. This younger generation, everybody says, oh, they're difficult to deal with. First of all, they're special and they're entitled. At least in the States, they've been told since they were born that they're special. You know what that means? What did they want? They want it free, they want it perfect, and they want it now. Huh? Anybody know what I'm talking about? They expect it. Look, they go to Amazon, they go to Starbucks, they want it free, they want it perfect, they want it now. Starbucks, it comes out, you only put one shot instead of two. They demand a refill, right? They demand a change. That younger generation is entitled, and affluence and entitlement are a dangerous combination. We all know that, right? You've all got members like that. Next thing is, we've got unlimited choices. Give you an example, the beach club. You got to have a philosophy of operations, and I agree completely with that. Something that's simple that everybody understands, just like Bill was saying. Our dining room at the beach club is in competition within 2 miles of 1,500 other restaurants. Huh? You want to know what competition is? How many of you have 1,500 other country clubs within 2 miles of your club? Huh? So you ask yourself, how do we win? Well, you have to define the market niche that you're going for. And this is ours. It's very simple. We are your neighborhood restaurant doing familiar food exceptionally well. How's that? That's all it is. That's about as funky and low-key as it gets. But what does a neighborhood restaurant give you? Relationships and community. Is that not true? That's what will fill the big hunger more than anything else. So, less loyalty. People say, oh, they leave all the time. Why do they leave? Why during the downturn in the economy did we lose no members at the beach club? Huh? And people say, oh, the money's gone. People find money for stuff they care about. Is that not true? You know what they're finding is? They just don't care enough about golf. Because sometimes the package isn't big enough. We're going to have a panel this afternoon. It's fabulous. What is the future of golf? This is exciting. Golf is a smaller slice of the club pie. That's what I'll tell you right off the bat. Golf is an excuse to have relationships and community, to get the buzz from good services and programs. So they're less loyal. But I can tell you the principles of loyalty. We're going to go into it. Just, I can tell you why they leave. I can tell you the questions they ask themselves as to where they should go. They're impatient. They want it now. Remember, they want it perfect, they want it free, and they want it now. Huh, go on Amazon. I can go on there anytime. I don't have to go to a bookstore anymore. Norm talks to me about a book. I said, I'm going to check this out. Boom, 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 instant. And then it already has the algorithm for my profile. Technology is there to help you create what I call a market of one, right? That's what Amazon does. They put down there, oh, if you like this book by Norm, maybe you like all the other ones he's got, even the one that's out of print that is his best book. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Go after them. Check them out. All of a sudden, Amazon says, we know you. We know you. How many clubs are saying that? We'll take Amazon again. How many of you, for somebody who golfed at your club who's not a member, did you send a note to, handwritten note, and say, God, it was great having you with us at our club? Amazon does. They thank you for the order. Then a couple of weeks later, they'll send you a thing. Oh, have you seen? I'm a big history buff. My undergraduate degree is in history, so obviously I love this stuff. They send me, oh, a brand new book is coming out by an author that you've bought before. Huh? How many of you do that in your pro shop? Oh, we found out that last week you ordered three of this. Well, we got two new of that coming in. Would you like to buy those? Technology is there to support the market of one. Again, we are customizing what we do in the experience economy. Are you customizing in your club? That younger generation simply expects it. And if you don't do it, you lose. Those who use technology to customize that experience win. You know, the golf tours that we're talking about, what is the algorithm they're dealing with? You tell us the parameters and we'll tell you what. I'll give you an example. One of the things they were talking about in Lisbon, Paul, I think that was it. We're talking about pricing, yield management. What should you charge? It can get very complicated. So this club was saying, this is all you got to do. Tell me how much you want to spend for a round of golf, and I'll tell you what day during the week you can play and at what time. How's that? Huh. Does that make it simple? Yes, it does. Or if somebody can say, you want to play at a certain time on a certain day, I'll tell you how much it costs. That's simple. So we're going to talk into some loyalty things. They're always connected. This is where technology comes. They want to feel connected, right? Have you done that? Simple stuff. Family-oriented, this is a big deal in the States. I remember when I was a kid back in the 50s, I'm an old geeky guy, right? And I would go up to my mom and say, oh, mama, this Sunday, let's do this. She'd smack me in the side of the head. You go where mama tells you to go, right? Times have changed, at least in the States. Parents go where the kids tell them to. Do you know, and this is a great point that Henry made, 75% of the financial and social decisions made in families, at least in the States, are made by women. What percentage of your members are women? Maybe if you increase the percentages, your chances of getting more people to come in would be even greater. Huh? Who makes those decisions? The family has become a more dominant element. Do you know why? There are fewer kids now than ever before. The more affluent a society becomes, the fewer kids parents have. Simple as that. So, and I'd like to say, we're lonelier than we've ever been before. Huge opportunity in this day and age. People say, oh, they lost their jobs back in 2008-9. Great. Where do they go to recreate and to feel the love? They come to the club. That's what you should be doing. So it's not just a commodity. We must go beyond that. So these are questions they're asking. If you want my business, you've got to answer these questions. You want somebody's loyalty? Huh? You better answer these questions. Do you know me? Right? Now, me is two things, macro and micro. Do you know the micro me? Do you know what I bought last time I came down? Do you know the days of the week I played and the times that I played and how much I paid at those times? Do you know me as an individual? Do you know my name? Do you know my spouse's name? Do you know my kid's name? Do you know where I went to school? Technology gives us the opportunity to know people in a way we've never known them before. And it's our responsibility to use that technology so that we can, in fact, create that market of one. Because in the experience economy, I'll keep repeating this, people are looking for a customized experience in the market of one. I am a market segment of one. So, and then secondly, do you know me as a category? Do you know me as a young 30-year-old business executive from Silicon Valley? Do you think they want to wear formal club attire when they go out and play golf? I bet a nickel they don't, but they could buy and sell the golf course. Do you know them as a group? How about women? Women are the classic things. We had an Irish gal over in Lisbon. I thought she was fabulous, talking about why women don't play golf. What are the barriers to their playing? Do you know your market segments? Do you understand them as a segment? And then do you understand all the individuals that you have? Now keep this in mind as well. It is far cheaper to keep the people who've already used you than it is to go after new people. That's what it comes down to. Go after the people you've already got. And I'd like to go into this. We could go into this for some time and say, okay, what are you doing to embrace the people who are regular users of your facility? Because losing them is a huge loss, because getting those people back can cost you 10 times as much as that might be. Do you equal my expectations? What do they want? What are their expectations in this day and age, right? Do you know what they are? We should sit here and do an examination right now. Nobody leaves the room until we finish the examination. I want you to list the five top market segments in your club and give me the expectations of each of those market segments. Go. And if you can't do it, you shouldn't be managing your club. Ha ha ha. Terrible thing to say, but it's true, right? It all starts at the top, right? That's what it comes down to. You must be that magician, right? Everything that Norm talked about, just write down those 6 points and go through and start asking those questions. Next thing is, do you make my life better? And this is where the experience economy comes in. Starbucks makes poor people's lives better. Is it not true? Because they touch upon something that is special and unique that they otherwise could not afford. That's why Starbucks makes. I have an assistant, my membership director at the Beach Club. She, I won't say it, but she doesn't have a pot to piss in. She doesn't have a lot of money. She never saved her money, spends it all on the opera. Every afternoon for her break, she goes up into Brentwood, which is an expensive part of Los Angeles, buys the most expensive coffee in the most expensive coffee shop on the stupid street. You know why? Because it makes her feel good. It is an experience she's willing to pay for. People will stretch to have stuff that have enlarged experiences. Is that not true? Absolutely. They will stretch to be members of your club. They'll be stretched to play at your club if the experiences you provide exceed the cost of giving it. So do you make my life better? Do you make my life easier? This is where technology comes in. Have you made it easier? Huh? Let me give you, when you walk in the door at the Beach Club and everybody gives you the wave, before you come off the highway, I'll just give you an example. You're ready to turn in because it's real busy on the Pacific Coast Highway. Security guard's waving to him. You park your car. You walk in, 100 yards away, they shout out your name and wave to you. Huh? You're already feeling bad. They open the door for you. They give your kid the knuckles and they shake your hand and you come in, right? You come in. Do they make those lives better? Liz Sides come in. I go by, it happened the other day. I ought to take videos of this. She's sitting there, 95 years old. She drinks like a fish, smokes all the time. Fabulous gal, right? Not to say that that's good for your lifestyle, but she does it. I come up to her and she's got her two Filipino girls with her, right? You know, taking care of her, keeping her alive. And I say, Lizzie, Wizzy, how's it going today, princess? Oh, great, Gregg. And I give her a knuckle, a 95-year-old woman, I give the knuckles. Woo, 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 woo. She'll keep paying $450 a month and buying watered-down wine because her son, who's like 80 himself, says, you better water down the wine for my mother or else I'm going to smack you. Huh? Printing money on this woman. What have we given her? We've given her something that other clubs, she's also a member of another prestigious West Side club, I won't go into it, sort of like the Congressional Country Club, but anyway, that's neither here nor there, right? Do you make my life easier? Lastly, do you do it differently than to get it someplace else? That's the key thing. How many of you play golf in Scotland? Fabulous place. Paul, I'm sure you have, right? Fabulous. I know Jimbo has too. Sorry, I shouldn't call Jim singling Jimbo, but it's Jimbo to me. He's played golf over there. Why? I remember one time we were up north there, north of Inverness. What does that play? Doorknock. I remember I was out there because I'm a big walker. I was going around. And I love golf courses over there because you got dogs running across it, horses jumping over things, rocks in the middle of the fairway. It's fabulous. And I saw Jimbo out there with this other guy. They're carrying their own bags, right? No carts over there. The wind was howling. His hair, and there's not much of it, was standing right up. And I said, right on. He had a memorable moment. Did he not? He got more experience from that from doing one of those, what they call them, parklands courses, you know, where you drive around your car and the whole thing, where it's like driving a car, right? People are buying cars now that insulate you from the car experience. I cannot believe it. Why would you do that? I'm a motorcycle guy. I want to see that engine right out there. I want to feel the dripping grease. I want to rub it on my pants. Sorry. It's one of those things, right? Do you do it differently than other people do it? In the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. I want you to steal your ideas from all the clubs. You know why? Because then you're going to be just like everybody else. You will never imitate your way to success. Does everybody understand? That's why when I heard, I forget who it was talking to, it hit it right on the nose. Take the idea, maybe it was Henry, take the idea and make it your own. Huh? Interpret it differently. I like to use different words than the NBA type guys would use. Spanking the competition. Huh? Make it up yourself. Have some passion for the ideas, and you'll have passion for ideas if those ideas are your own. So, questions they're asking. Again, you're talking now about feeding the big hunger. The hunger hasn't changed, right? Do you take their loneliness away? I'll give you an example. We've got a huge market in kids that have graduated from college and have just started out in business. Some of the loneliest people I've ever met. You know why? Because they were in college. They live in the dormitories. They have the classes. Life is easy. You have your social circle designed. Once you graduate, you are alone. And I'm sure all of you know what it's like to be in a city that you never grew up in, right? Do you working with people you never met before they hired you? Horror story. Loneliness. You want loyalty from your people? Do you remove their loneliness, the big hunger? Do you reduce their fear? I love it. They come into a golf course and you wonder, am I dressed right? Huh? Happens all the time. What have you done to dissolve their fear? I'll give you an example. You just paid $70,000 for a stupid beach club membership, right? Can't use it. You know why? Because until you get oriented, you're not one of us. So you have to sit through the general manager's three-hour orientation. It's a howl, boys and girls. Those people at the end of the day, the men are giving me the big shoulder, right? The women are giving me the ear kiss. It's love, right? How many of you take away the fear by doing a long orientation with each individual couple? Individual couples, not groups, individual couples, huh? Because fear is part of who they are, huh? How can you participate? You know one of the things we do with fear? By contrast, I love committees. I got this thing called committee love. The more the merrier. Bill, it's done, piss on it. Okay, no, we're almost done. Okay, dignity, status, and the buzz. Now, what we're talking about, questions they're asking. Before they come back to your club, they will ask these questions once they've come into your club door once, right? First of all, did they satisfy my value equation? Now, what does that mean? Everyone who comes in has this value equation in mind. Value equals experience minus cost. And they're saying, did I get enough experience here to warrant the cost? Huh? Ask yourself that. Did they? And if they didn't, you could lose because nobody wants to overpay. Value isn't about how much they pay. You all understand that. But the experiences that you have. Next thing, do they deliver the Starbucks experience? Is it personalized? Is it customized? Do they deliver the Amazon experience? Do they anticipate your needs before you even know you need it? Huh? Next thing is, do you deliver the Blues Brothers experience? You've gone outside the barriers of experience. You've thrown off the chains and the shackles. By way of example, your golf course does so every Saturday, one Saturday a month, you use 18-inch holes on the course, huh? It's different. I don't know if you do it or not, but the fact of the matter is, outside the norm, you want to put your thumb in the eye of the guy. How many people have seen that philosophical movie called The School of Rock? You ought to watch it. What is the purpose of rock and roll? Stick it to the man. That's what young people want. You want to know what young people want? They want to stick it to the man, huh? They don't want to come to your club if they have to wear the, you know, the green pants and the orange shirt. They're out of there. Almost there, right? Do you deliver more zings per minute? You should do an encounter map at your club and say, have we done something interesting at each point of contact along the way when the person thinks about the club and by the time they leave the club. Each of those points of contact must become an experience that is memorable. Do you let me escape adulthood? We got a lot of kids right now. One of our big events is called the Beer Olympics. How many people go to Beer Olympics at their club? Fabulous. And you know who comes to it? Everybody who's under 40 years of age comes here. You know why? Because they want to believe that they're still in college. They don't get whacked. They don't get crazy. They want to escape from adulthood, right? It's been too oppressive for too long. I love it in Korea, right? They kill these kids from an early age in order to get them to pass tests and one thing and the next. They would be perfect targets for me if I was out here, because I know when they come to my club, they want to cast off those chains that keep that animal spirit in place. Do you release my animal spirits? Next thing is, okay, the process. We're almost done. How do you come up with ideas? That's why you're here at this conference. This is the process. It's very easy. I just go really fast, because business people are in the business of solving problems, and you solve problems with ideas. Now, Bill was talking about every single one of your employees is a fountain, if they're the right employees, are a fountain of information. I can tell you, again, these are not abstractions for me. I do this stuff all the time. And I'll tell you how my staff does it and what we do and how we come up with ideas. But the first thing is, you should write down right now, what are your troubles? Just what Norm was saying. Maybe your trouble is you want to have a full membership by 2017. Fabulous. That's your trouble. Next thing is, yeah, who do you talk to? Who are the network of people that you rely on to come up with answers? I tell you, one for me would be Michael Lemus, right? Boom. Michael, I can call up Michael because I know him, and I bet he'll take my phone call. But if I was John Deere, he wouldn't. Simple as that, right? Next thing is consume. Where do you get ideas from? The easiest thing is Google. Go to Google, put in whatever it is, you get 100,000 ideas. It's free. It's cheap. Both of these are cheap and free. I hate to say it, Norm, we don't have to hire an outside specialist, because we should be able to do this ourselves. That's what your magician does. They translate, they find ideas and they translate them into action. Brew and stew, you think about it. Norm and I were talking about this. I'm a bicyclist. I bicycle to club every day. It's 13 miles away. And then I come up with an idea. I take out my notepad. I write it down. I put it back. Norm's a runner. He runs along. And of course, he tries to remember in his head. Oh, remember this, remember this. You're getting old enough, Norm, so you ain't going to remember nothing. Keep that in mind. I've been there. I am there. Then after you come up with the ideas, you ink it. You have to translate vision into linear action. What are the 10 steps we're going to take, the actual tactics to make this sort of thing happen? Flop and fumble, 99.73% of your ideas will be failures. What did you say, Bill? 1,000 good ideas before you get one that's successful. You gotta accept that, that's fun. My brother, I learned from my brother who's an engineer. He says, Gregg, we engineers, he has a different personality than me. He says, Gregg, we don't worry about that. It's just a data point. We throw it against the wall. If it doesn't work, it's just a data point. We know it doesn't work. I can tell you hundreds of things that didn't work for me that became seed ideas for successful ideas thereafter. We can go into that. You digest it, and then you reconstitute. You do it differently. Time to do. We're going to finish it off right here. I made it. Close to it anyway, right? Didn't go an hour over like I thought I was going to do. One, the manager's mission. You want to be judged as a manager? A CMAA Asia? I tell you, this is how you judge it. Your job is to attract members, to retain members, to get them to use the club more, and last, to do it all efficiently, with the least expenditure of time, money, and resources. But the problem I run into with the next generation, Norm and I were talking about this last night, they're MABWAs. Do you know what a MABWA is? An MBA without soul, right? They're numbers guys, right? They're gonna lose. So what we have to figure out is efficiency is only 25% of your job. Yet everybody talks about efficiently. See, I was about to say, are you your club's dancing monkey? And not, who is your dancing monkey? Because dancing monkeys give the buzz, the love, and the glow. Who's yours? Ask yourself that right now. Next thing, identify the questions. Oh, needs are the same. They're satisfied differently. Know what a person's needs are, and it's easy to satisfy them because you can focus. Find the answers using the process. Vision without action is a daydream. We keep hearing this all the time. It's great to come up with ideas while you're here at conference. Now you need to translate them into action. And this is where that magician comes in that takes raw ingredients and makes something special out of it. So the key now is to enjoy the journey. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to be here for a couple of days. I think on the third day, I'm actually going to do this thing called the nudge. How do you move your club in a direction it needs to go in and they don't even know it yet? That's a biggie. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.